Morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very glad to be here in Lisbon and to have the opportunity to, let's say, to contribute to the project. And especially we have here a case study which is not the best case study for Lisbon. There is no snow and there are stadiums, of course, but you are working in a highway authority and you are more interested in bridges or tunnels. So this is another type of case study, but I hope it will be interesting for you. And it's a case study. We have agreed upon how to present the case study. So there will be first the decision scenario, what is important to decide, and what is the asset description, and what is the monitoring strategy. Then the methods which have been applied, but very briefly, I don't go to theoretical details, I just mention them, some results. And of course, what is the critical thing is the value of the information for the owner. And open questions, because we are very interested into a kind of feedback from the industry and discussion. So the decision scenario, if you are in Central Europe or also in Northern Europe, you have a lot of snow and there have been damages in industrial buildings under snow load, ice arenas also. And we have here a stadium roof which does not comply with the requirements in the Eurocode. So if you try to verify the basic components of the structure, they cannot fulfill the new Eurocodes because the snow load is higher than the originally snow load which has been used in the design. So the snow load dominates the reliability. It's a light roof, and if you have a light roof, the snow load is the highest load. So what you can do here, it's a different part. Usually if you think of monitoring, you monitor a bridge and you're monitoring a parameter which influences the resistance of your structure. We heard about fatigue, we heard about corrosion, you can do also other things, measure deflections and so on. So you are more thinking in the resistance, but the safety, the reliability of your structure is of course depending also on the actions. And here you can directly monitor the snow load or the parameters affecting the snow load. So the difference here is we can monitor a parameter which is directly affecting the reliability of the structure. When a specified limit value of the monitor parameter is exceeded, either that you can have the actions, either you can remove the snow load, which is also expensive, or you can close the stadium for the event and wait. So there have been some damages under snow load, as I said. So the asset description first, we have to, if we want to take some decision, we have to take all the information, as I said before, from the design state. So we have a stadium which is constructed in the beginning of the 90s. It is 190 meters above sea level in northern Italy. It is for 4,000 spectators, so you can classify it. The Eurocodes provide some classifications. They are similar in other standards. So CC3 means consequence class 3 is the highest classification with the highest consequences in case of failure. This is the simple system. It's a cantilever beam. And we have spacing between the beams every 5 meters with connected stiffening members. So you can also do some system analysis, not member analysis, but this is not so important for now. We have done that. So you see here the old code was 0.9 kilonewton per square meter, and the new code has about 30% higher design, higher characteristic value for the snow.
if you look at the design requirements, if you check the structure, you might see that the resistance is about 90% of the resistance provided in the Eurobond. And if you try to verify the structures, you will see that you do not fulfill the current standard, the Eurocode. So you can measure the snow load, yeah? And there are different possibilities. You don't even need to measure on the roof. You have stations close to your stadium and you can take the snow load on ground. However, you have to relay the snow load on the ground, or the snow depth and the snow load, they measure both. They measure also the density, so you should imagine you have the depth, the snow depth, multiplied with the density, and the density has a very high variability. It can be very small to close to water, so to ice, so it can be very, very, very heavy. And the uncertainty, of course, is high if you just use the meteorological station. There are also systems where you can measure the snow depth, and you can have also some cost to buy this system and also to maintain the system for some years. And then you can have also there are systems, the most advanced, where you can directly measure the snow load on the roof, and you can have an alert if it is higher than a certain snow load, which is, let's say, close to your acceptable risk level. You get an alert and you have to decide what to do. So the methods which have been applied here are uncertainty modeling. You have the uncertain snow load, you have predictions for a couple of days, so you can use them also. You can assign also some uncertainty there. You have uncertainty also in your resistance parameters, but they are not as high as in the load parameters, as I mentioned in the beginning. You have reliability analysis, so you can compute the safety of your component or of your system, and the safety is reflected in the so-called reliability index. The higher the reliability index, the safer the structure. So a typical value can be 4 or 5. 5 means it is safer or more reliable your component compared to 4. Then you can, this is an important part, what can happen if you have failure? Of course, it can happen when nobody is there, but it could also happen where people are there. So you have to look, you have economical costs, you have also human consequences. And then you can also apply to combine this, a kind of risk assessment, to combine probability that something will happen together with the associated consequences. And as I mentioned before, we have a kind of measure of reliability, which is the reliability index. And if you assign a so-called target reliability index, which reflects the acceptability criteria of risk, and I said values typically are from 3 to 5, this would be in practice depend on the costs, on the investment into cost of safety. The higher the investments into cost of safety, and also the higher the costs are, then the lower the target reliability would be. And this is in practice done also in the highway where you are working. For example, imagine a tunnel, a big tunnel, then you would not construct in the tunnel an emergency lane. Because it's very expensive, you have to construct a larger tunnel, so it is a typical reflection of this principle which combines the investments into safety with the consequences. So if the investments, these are very small numbers, because the failure consequences are really high, so if the investment into safety gets higher, the target reliability would get lower. The Eurocodes currently, they say for CC3 structures you should use 5.2, which is a really high value. And you can go lower if you apply other codes or standards or guidelines. So there are more, let's say, modern guidelines like the ISO 2394, which reflects these aspects, costs related to investments into safety and cost of failure. which is something you are applying in practice. You are applying it in bridges, you are applying it in tunnels, but you don't have a direct reflection on how to apply it. So this is another parameter here, which is important. What to do with existing structures which do not fulfill current codes, and how to deal with cost problems. So this is in case, of course, of exceedance of a limit. So we have the parameter, which is here, the performance parameter. It is the snow load, but it is directly related to the reliability. So therefore, is this case study very simple. You have the snow load, everybody can understand. The higher the snow load, the worse is the situation for the safety of the stadium. And you can directly reflect it or relate it, it's better, to the reliability, target reliability. And you have two costs. The one is the cost of safety measures, clean the stadium, don't do the event, which of course is you lose money, and failure costs. And here you have to relate failure costs to some monetary value, which is possible to be done, because you have human, you have fatalities, injuries, and you have also economic damage here, business loss and so on. And as I mentioned in the beginning, you have three monitoring strategies with three different uncertainties related to these monitoring strategies. Monitoring strategy number one, you have your monitoring, which is actually done without any costs because you have meteorological stations close to the stadium. So you are monitoring the snow on the ground. You can monitor this is very cheap. You can monitor the snow depth, but you have the uncertainty on the snow density. You can monitor the snow depth on the roof. And you can monitor it directly with modern devices, the snow load directly, which has a very good precision. Of course, there is always some uncertainty. And now you have to look at the costs. What are your costs of the monitoring systems? So you have the acquisition cost, you have to buy it, you have the operational cost, and cost when the limit, and cost of safety measures when the limit is exceeded. So you have also to see how many times during the residual lifetime of this stadium or of your structure the limit will be exceeded. So this will be one or two times in the next 20 years, for example, because you have experience, and we did that for a reference period of 20 years here. So you can see for the results which are obtained, again, you see the reliability which is covered depending on the measured ground snow load here, the snow depth, and the snow load on the roof. Yeah? So the higher the load is, of course, the lower the reliability which is covered by your structure. Or existing structures. So the monitor values versus target reliability is here a typical result. You can apply them also here, the framework which was explained before. You have the plan investigations, which are here done. You have the results of the investigation, which is the measured parameter. Then you have the decisions, close the stadium, clean the stadium, do nothing, three possible decisions. And then you can see after all what are the related in each three cases costs which are involved in these possibilities. Here is a typical, this is a typical previous measurements which you have. So you see, as soon as you get to the limit, you have to clean the stadium, and then you will have to clean it maybe a second time in a couple of years. So what is interesting here is what is the benefit of this, let's say, somehow simple structural health monitoring, which is done through the load. It provides limit values for loads and corresponding to some risk acceptability criteria, which you have to put in your structure. It allows for real-time evaluation, so you have a kind of reliability online. It supports decisions regarding to safety measures, so you can apply all these ideas, investment into safety, failure costs, and so on. It can lead to a more economical solution compared to an expensive upgrade, because it would be very expensive to demolish a structure to upgrade to fulfill the Eurocode. It indicates also the optimal strategy, so it has been found that the direct measuring of the snow load is the best option, the most economical one. And also, what is important for me, it increases the research knowledge. So you try, you develop new standards, you have a better reputation also in research, it is reflected also in future applications, so this is also one benefit which cannot be directly quantified into money, but it is of an essential issue for me. And also it adds, as I said, to the reputation. If you do this, you get as a company or as an owner a better reputation. So these are, you have, let's say, some hard benefits and some soft benefits which are indirect benefits. Cannot be easily quantified into money, but they are there. And assist development of standards, as I said before. So the open questions, I'm finishing here for, as we discussed, we have to, our open questions here is what to do with existing structures which are not fulfilling current standards. It's a typical problem in many countries. How can we use value of information in practice? And of course, very open question is how to estimate cost of failure in case something is happening, in case we have a collapse of the structure. Thank you very much for your attention.
If nobody else wants to say anything, then let me start. So normally when we are trying to manage the safety of structures, we are addressing two types of criteria. And the same also applies for the criteria provided in ISO 2394, namely criteria directly derived from cost efficiency of structures and criteria related to safety for people exposed to the performance of structures. So in this study here, I think you started out with some criteria from the Eurocodes with very high levels of betas, and then you were pointing at other codes and guidelines. So with respect to the actual type of criteria, life safety or cost efficiency, what did you choose here?
For human safety.
Yeah.
Not in your study.
Yeah, we choose the criterion of optimization of economy, so the relation between cost of failure to cost of investment. So cost of failure you have to quantify. So we have, let's say, we have to put some monetary value to the cost of human life, and we did that in terms of the LQI principle, so life quality index. So we have optimization and human safety, which have to be fulfilled here. At the end, the result was that a reliability of 3.7 would cover both, and it's lower compared to the 5.2, which you have to fulfill in the Eurocode.
I don't know if you have similar problems in Portugal.
And maybe another type of approach to a question. Now we have decision makers here. So in the case, let's say what was the starting point for this case study or this study altogether? Because you could imagine that there would be many structures out there that have been designed for according to an old code, and then things have changed in the code developments, and the structures are not fully complying the most recent codes now, and all these structures are still standing there, right? Until Professor Diamantidis comes and say that maybe there's something to look at, or somebody else gets the idea that maybe we need to consider whether the structures are still up to present standards. The initiator of such a study is kind of important, and the regulation around it also, because if there's no duty or responsibility for the building owner specifically to keep track on such changes, then it may actually be better for the building owner, for the decision maker, not to do anything, because the only thing that will come out of that is expenses, right? Did you think about that?
Yeah. To the first question, which is very interesting, is how did we choose this example? And all the examples were bridges. So I was, and I'm very glad that Sebastian and Michael involved us into this project. We thought about something which is understandable. I was listening to many, it's very complicated for bridges. You have these performance indicators. There was a whole session on performance indicators. So I was a little bit thinking, what is a performance? So the first thing we tried to present some, let's say, case study which in which the reliability is directly related to which the value which you are measuring. So you don't have some complicated transformation from stiffness of bridges to the safety of the bridge and so on. And the second thing is, this problem is in all countries. We have a lot of existing structures which do not fulfill the codes. And the situation is that, according to my opinion, standardization committees, and they are pretending that you have to fulfill the Euro codes and so on, even if you don't fulfill. So you need some clear guidelines what to do in that case. Because 50% of the structures are existing structures and of the budget spent. Take, for example, the tunnels. After the accident we had in the tunnels, the directive changed, the 2004 directive, and you have to implement much more stricter criteria. So half of the tunnels do not fulfill this criteria. The European Community gives time until 2020 to fulfill the criteria or to put other safety measures which are somehow equivalent to those new safety measures. So there are guidelines which are trying to reflect this effect, but not as strong as the reality is, according to my experience. So there is, in fact, needed to use this information. Yeah, I
agree. we need to stop this interesting discussion, unfortunately. But I think this small discussion after the presentation points at two things, in my opinion. So responsible building owners, responsible structural system owners is a very, very important point here. And the other point is the regulations. Regulations actually specifying that some minimum monitoring has to be undertaken is necessary. So imagine the case that your structure actually fulfills the most recent code requirements, right? The design loads were exactly according to what the code is prescribing. But then we have a super heavy snowfall, and it just exceeds the, the assumed conditions at the point of design. Does that mean that we shouldn't do anything? If it's completely obvious you have a roof with 4 meters of snow, but there has to be some sort of legal fix in the codes which just implement sound reasoning, right? That when you see things which are clearly above design criteria, then you need to do something. So responsible owners, but also codes which directly and explicitly incorporate structural health monitoring at least a minimum level, right?